Hey YouTube, welcome back to another gun review video. Today I've got something very special for you, and it is a revolver, and it is the Smith & Wesson Model 637. Now, this revolver is a 38 special caliber gun, and it holds 5 rounds of ammunition. So as always, when we're handling any firearm, we make sure that the gun itself is completely unloaded. It's a lot easier to do with revolvers than it is some semi-automatic guns, because in this gun you can pop the barrel to the side and see that all the chambers are empty. There is no chamber inside the frame itself or anything for a bullet to be lodged in like semi-automatic guns could have. So if you pop this open and you see that it's empty, then you know that is safe to handle. Now, always, anytime you're looking at any gun, no matter if you know it's unloaded or not, always practice common sense safety. Never point it at anyone or anything that you would ever want to lose. Now that all the safety talk is out of the way, let's get into the actual review of the gun. When I keep the gun, I usually keep it unloaded unless I plan on taking it somewhere, in which case I'll load it up. But normally what I'll do is when I unload it, I'll put the little plastic ring that it came with back inside so that I can easily see that this gun is not loaded. You can see by the red through there, and even if you're looking down the gun for whatever reason, you could kind of see the red through there. Never ever look into a gun. Now, this is a very standard Smith & Wesson style revolver. In order to unlock the barrel, you simply push forward on the thumb release here, and you push out on the barrel. You don't want to push a lot of pressure, and if it's stuck or sticky, don't push very hard because you could actually damage the firearm. Now, with revolvers in general, you see a lot of movies where someone will load it up and they'll spin it and they will flick the gun closed, and that is actually also bad for the gun itself. There are a number of things that can actually go wrong with the gun, including you can bend the frame of the gun so that these two points right there will not actually seat together. So if you're buying a used revolver, see how those line up. If there's a big gap between there, then there is a pretty good chance that that gun has been mistreated. Also, inside here, you can see this little metal tab right there, and every time you flick it shut, you're essentially ramming the chambers up against that little pin. Now, odds are it probably won't do much to it if you do it a couple times, but extended abuse like that could actually damage your firearm. Now, this gun is a single double action gun, meaning if you pull the trigger, it will pull back the hammer and it will fire. But also being single action, you can pull back the hammer manually and then pull the trigger. Now, if you pull the trigger without the hammer pulled back, it is a really long and hard pull, which if you're trying to get any accuracy during testing, if you're at the range and trying to see how this thing sights in, that long trigger pull could actually affect your accuracy because as you're pulling it, you could pull down on the gun, and that would definitely affect how the gun shoots. And when you cock the hammer back, you could see that the trigger is pretty much all the way at the back. It moves very, very, very small. So if I try to pull the trigger, you can see how little it actually moves before it fires. So you're talking about a distance traveled of that much versus having the hammer back and moving, you know, a couple of hairs in distance. So it really does have a pretty smooth trigger. I mean, you barely put any pressure on this at all and it fires, which can also be dangerous. You don't really want to be walking around with this thing cocked and loaded in your pocket. That could be very bad. Like I said, any small amount of pressure could set this thing off. So imagine if your keys or something else bumped out in your pocket. Don't carry your guns like that. That would be stupid and very dangerous. Now, as far as the ammunition goes, basically, in order to load it, you pop open the barrel and you can see that all the chambers are currently empty. But what you would do is you would just put your shells into each chamber and then you would close the gun. And when you close it, you want to make sure that it's locked into place. Sometimes if it closes in the middle, you'll notice that there's play here, and the gun should align itself when you go to fire it, but to be safe, anytime you close it, lock it into place. That way you know that the gun is going to work for you. If you're buying a used revolver, cycle the gun through to make sure that each of the chambers properly line up. You want to make sure that each chamber properly rotates into position as you're cycling through, and if it doesn't, that could be signs that there are issues with the gun itself. And when you want to eject the shells, all you have to do is push forward, pop open the barrel, and you push in on this pin here. And then you can see that little extractor comes out, and it should push out the shells. Now, being this style of gun, it doesn't have a full-length extractor pin as you'd see on longer-barreled models. So, in theory, you could run into some issues where the shells don't fully eject and you might have to pull them out a little bit. But if you're not really too concerned about that, it does work most of the time pretty flawlessly. Now, the sights on this gun are pretty standard. You can see that there are no colored pieces. There's no illuminated pieces, no plastics, anything like that. And it's just a groove and your front sight. So when you're looking down it, there's not a ton that you're going to be able to use for aiming. But then again, this is a, I believe it's a 1.9 inch barrel. In fact, this thing would be mostly for personal protection. You could carry this gun and it would be for pretty short distances. I mean, anytime you get on really long distances, this thing is not really going to perform all that well just because of the very small barrel that it has. Now, that could be one thing that you're looking for when you're thinking of a concealed carry gun. And, you know, you might even consider something like this as a backup. If you have another gun and you want something as a secondary gun, I believe this would still make a pretty good choice. Now, it does come in a model that does not have the hammer, and it is double action only, but I do like the single actionness of it, especially when you're at the range. It's pretty fun just to, you know, easily be able to pull the trigger and have the gun fire versus having to pull that long trigger pull every single time. Now, another downfall that some people might say about this gun is that it only carries 5 rounds. A lot of revolvers carry that 6th round, but even that 6th round isn't going to do you a whole lot of good if you're going to be in a situation where you need tons of ammunition. Now, like I said, that's why I kind of would consider this gun as more of a either light-duty gun or just like a backup to something else that you've already got, just because it doesn't have a very long barrel. It doesn't have a lot of rounds of ammunition that it carries, but it is still a .38 special gun. Now, something else to note is that this gun is a plus P gun. It on the barrel, it says, I don't know if you guys will be able to make that out, but it says 38 Smith & Wesson Special Plus P. So that means that this gun can handle plus P loads, which means you could get a little more firepower out of it than your standard 38 special rounds. Now, one of the reasons why I chose to go with this gun is that it just feels better in my hand. I handled a lot of guns and a lot of them didn't feel right. Like this one, when it's in your hand, it really fits well within your palm. You can get a nice grip on it and it feels very sturdy. A lot of the other guns that I was holding had more of a straight handle and it just kind of felt awkward while I was holding it. I didn't really feel very comfortable holding it, and I could imagine that shooting it would probably be just as uncomfortable. And that's why I ended up going with this one, just because I really like how it feels. Now, it does have removable rubber grips that you can pull off and swap out if you want like a wood grain stock or if you want something else altogether. One other thing to note is that this gun does have an internal trigger and hammer lock, and it comes with these little keys right here. Basically, it's a little hollowed out Allen wrench, pretty much, and it kind of just fits inside of this hole right below or right above the thumb release there. So I don't think we'll be able to get too good of a picture on that, but all you really do is you put the key inside there and you turn it, and you'll see right there, you can see this little tab popping up, and basically what that tab says is it says locked. Now, I can still open the revolver up and extract the rounds, put new rounds in, but if I tried to pull back the hammer or pull the trigger, it will not let me. Now, I could push on this locked thing all day. It's not going to release it. And some people like this and some people don't. It's a way that you could store the gun somewhere, and just in case somehow your kids got access to it, they wouldn't actually be able to use the firearm unless they, of course, found the keys and knew how to use them. Now, there have been stories where people have had issues with these locks activating at the wrong times. They don't have them activated and then they kick into place and they are unable to use their firearms. But I'm hoping that that's overall something that has been corrected over the years. I haven't really heard too many recent stories about them. Granted, I haven't done a ton of research on it, but I mean, that is something to consider. I believe there are ways to remove it if you want, but that's not something that I would ever feel comfortable doing. But if you wanted to have that done, I'm not even sure if that's legal to do. I've never really thought about removing them. It really doesn't bother me. I've never had any issues with them, but that is something to consider. So overall, the weight of this gun, it does feel nice. It's got some weight to it, which does help with the recoil. And that is definitely something that I was considering, because there were a lot of other guns that I was holding that just felt like they were half the weight of this gun. They were very light, and I just didn't feel comfortable with them because it didn't feel right. You would probably feel a lot more kick from one of the lighter frame guns than you would with this. And it also just, it didn't feel right to me. It was off balance. When you're holding this, it feels perfect in your hand. It really does. Now, as far as shooting this goes, it does have some kick to it. I'm not going to lie. It's a smaller gun, and when you pull the trigger, you definitely feel it. It's nothing that you can't handle. I mean, unless you're only used to shooting 22s, in which case it would probably have some major kick to it. But overall, it's a very smooth gun. It feels good. And I love revolvers because it really gets you into the feel of shooting. So if you're a gun fanatic and you don't own a revolver, I would suggest at least trying one out to see if you kind of like it. It's a completely different experience. Now, we talked about a couple things earlier about, you know, how there's only 5 rounds inside here and it's a short barrel. But one of the good things about revolvers that you don't get with semi-automatics is increased reliability. In a semi-automatic gun, if you pull the trigger and nothing happens, there's a number of things that could be wrong with it. You could have the magazine not inserted. You could have a dead round inside the chamber. Your gun might not have seated properly. There's a whole bunch of things that could have happened, and the scenario for that would usually be to tap the magazine, try to rack the gun. Hopefully, it would go back into battery. If it doesn't, drop the magazine, rack it a few times, put it back in, rack another round of the chamber, and then fire it again. Whereas with the revolver, if you pull the trigger and nothing happens, well, then you just keep pulling the trigger, and you have 4 more chances in this case of the gun being fired. So, for example, if you have a round in the chamber that has a bad primer, instead of having to eject that one and feed the next one, and all you simply do is you pull the trigger. So as far as being able to get a shot off, you know, you can quickly take your second follow-up shot with this versus the process of racking and trying to pull it again on a semi-automatic pistol, especially for concealed carry and as something where you may only need a single shot or two. I mean, 38 Special has some decent power behind it. It's not quite a 357, but it still will do some damage, and it was used in law enforcement for a very long time. So, like I said, would I use this piece as my primary carry pistol? Probably not. Probably not. I would probably use this as a backup, or maybe if I was just running up to a drive-through real quick or something, I just had to grab something in my pocket, or I'm not too concerned about things like that, you know, I could probably bring this. But overall, this is an amazing gun. The price on this is actually pretty good when compared to a lot of other pistols out there. And it's just because the size of it and just the look of it, too. You know, I love the Smith & Wesson black handle silver gun. It's just, it's a really nice looking gun. And it's very high quality. It's not the highest quality gun you can get. There are, you know, some imperfections with it, and there are nicer models. But for what I want this thing for, just as like a secondary gun, just a backup revolver in the 38 Special Caliber, this met all of my needs. So in conclusion, it's a great gun. It holds 5 rounds of ammunition. It has a shorter ejector rod, so you could have a little bit of issues getting the shells out, but I haven't really ran into that very much. It is a single double. Like I said, they do offer the exact same gun without the hammer. The back is a little bit elongated to hide the internal parts. And the only benefit with that would be if you're carrying this in your pocket without a holster, or even if you're in a holster and doesn't cover this back part up, this little hammer part could get hooked on something and make it hard to get out of your pocket or wherever you're keeping it. So that's why you might want to go with the hammerless one, but then you lose the ability to have it in single action. And one last thing that I wanted to talk about is how to safely decock the gun. Now, if you're really familiar with revolvers, in order to safely decock it, all you have to do is pull the trigger and then walk the hammer back down into the gun. But the way Smith & Wesson tells you to do it is by putting a thumb or another finger in between the hammer and the gun and then pulling the trigger. Because there's been times when I've been messing around with revolvers, just got done cleaning them, and I'm trying to, you know, run some cycles through it. And when I pull the trigger, it slips out of my finger, and technically that could make the gun fire and it could go off. So that is one thing to consider. However, there are some safety mechanisms in here that I'll just touch on very quickly. And basically how it works is the firing pin is not actually on the hammer. It's inside of the gun. Now, the only way the firing pin can ever hit the cartridge and be pushed forward is if the trigger is pulled all the way to the back. So if it's pulled all the way to the back, you probably can't see it, but you can see that at the top there, the firing pin pokes out. Now, if you let go of the trigger at all, you can see it no longer comes out when it hits there. And that is a safety mechanism. So that's why you're supposed to decock it, you're supposed to pull the trigger back until the hammer comes loose and then get your finger completely off the trigger. As soon as there's any gap behind the trigger, that plate should drop out of place and it should not be able to get struck and should not fire the gun. Now, I say should not just because it shouldn't happen, but that doesn't mean that it can't. So always practice safety. If you're not familiar, or even if you are, it still could be worth the second finger there just to make sure that it doesn't accidentally slip out of your thumb, especially if you're greasy or wet. So hopefully this helped you guys out. If you have any questions about this, please let me know in the comments. I'll try to answer your questions as best I can. And I really hope that you guys had fun. And hopefully you learned something about the gun. Now, I will be releasing another video soon showing how to take this thing down and clean it properly. And until then, thank you guys for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button to let me know how I'm doing. And if you didn't like it, let me know in the comments why. And I will see you guys later. Goodbye.